Hey guys, I'm Kevin.
And I'm Eric.
No one gives a f. So we went to film school together. How did you end up transitioning to the game industry?
So I was looking for film work out of school, and then I popped in a game a couple months after I graduated called Uncharted 2.
Okay. I've never heard of it.
I realized, you know, there have been games like movies before, but that was an interactive movie. That inspired me to take a job in games, audio or not. I went and I just took a game testing job. I did that for 6 months. So there was a student that I, you know, I guess I sort of taught or worked with. I noticed online that he was working at a game company, mm-hmm. and he was editing trailers. So I just kind of reached out to him and we got beers and found out that he was looking for someone. And I already had like game experience. It worked my way into
okay.
game audio from there.
So game testing obviously has the reputation for being the thing that everyone is supposed to think is a dream job, but everyone also knows is supposed to be the worst possible job you could ever take.
Yeah.
What's your opinion on that? And having moved out of testing, did you actually learn anything useful?
Yeah, I mean, I learned, you know, karaoke, hip hop, was my first ever game I worked on.
Am I allowed to use that clip?
Probably. I learned that there are ways to break something. How do you break something that you're so used to just kind of enjoying and not really looking for the faults in?
Right. I found I've had the reverse ability. I've been able to break every open world game I play
wow.
about 10 hours in. Like, hardcore, my file corrupts.
Huh.
Fallout New Vegas, I've made it about 4 hours. Red Dead Redemption broke for me about 10 hours in. Red Dead Redemption includes Josh Blaylock as the voice of the main character's son, who's also Brian in VGHS, and I never got to meet him because the game f***ed up.
Unlike Raiden, who we met. I'm there. You're there.
We were there. Quentin Flynn was there.
The Hudson River.
2 years ago.
The big thing that I'm personally curious about is when you're doing games, it's sort of a environment over which you don't have control.
Right.
When you're doing a film, you dictate exactly which sounds play when, and people hear exactly what you've
right.
picked. Like in Left 4 Dead, I always spam the character conversation options. Like whenever
right.
people are trying to get something done, I'm like, no, don't do that. What? When I'm doing a lot of film editing, I'm very conscious of what sounds are repetitive, things like that. But
right.
when you don't have control over that, are there any considerations?
Yeah. So something that's interesting about games is that you create like a wave asset in your mm-hmm. game engine. Can have a package of different sounds, like in a list, and it randomizes which one plays each time that event occurs. And a lot of times the same event happens over and over and over, and you have to create a wide variation of like 5 to 10 effects. You don't know which one will play in the mix,
right?
But
right.
it'll sound slightly different.
Well, I think of like, you know, a lot of old first-person shooters and stuff, and there's like 3 footsteps. Like, is that actually, when you're designing elements, can you play them back randomly?
So what we do is we create, there are levels in the final game, you know, that you
right.
play through. But when you're actually building the game, there are test levels. So you can like actually put certain things in them to happen. A lot of things you cannot make happen in the way that you'd want to test, but mm-hmm. you try and test it every way you can possibly test once you have the game up and running. If like the QA department is bugging things as well as they should be, then
yeah.
you should get, at some point...
Reports.
Yeah, some sort of report.
When
that,
you've messed up.
Yeah.
Software-wise, because you're obviously not working in Pro Tools, as you've mentioned before.
We could. Actually, a lot of game departments do, audio mm-hmm. teams. We chose Nuendo mm-hmm. over Pro Tools, but we could easily work in Pro Tools for the actual editing of assets.
You're designing individual elements the same way you would for a movie, but in terms of implementing them, do you have to know any other like coding software, anything like that?
Yeah, so there's some software that certain game engines are better with. Some work with software called WYS. Ours goes directly into the game engine. So we export, we have the, you know, the sound asset,
mm-hmm.
we bring it right into Frostbite, which is the game engine we're using. Frostbite.
That's actually like a custom thing that Frostbite provides.
Yeah.
So
it's
that's
all
not a guaranteed.
In.
Okay.
Right. Every game team is different. There are some companies where you have to work in a software like WYS and then implement from there
mm-hmm.
into the game engine.
In a way that's like 2 phases of the workflow, like one where you design the elements and the second one where they're all implemented. And
exactly.
And you,
yeah. The first
yeah.
part of it seems a lot like film. Like,
yeah. So you would say that's a pretty much a one-to-one
yeah.
in terms of skill set. Because I feel like for like YouTube stuff, like Video Game High School, because we have such quick turnarounds, I'm pre-designing all the weapon effects. And I'm sort of building just a library of like, these are 10 close gunshots, 10 medium
mm-hmm.
gunshots. And I feel like that might be like a pretty similar. Instead of implementing them into a game engine, they're just manually being cut and pasted and then, you know, tweaked
right.
a little bit by hand.
Right,
but,
right.
But in a way, I English. As opposed to like working on a film, you know, where you're dealing with like a picture editor and stuff like that, what's the communication like working on a game? Is there a lot of, in your particular situation, a lot of freedom to kind of just try things out or...
There definitely is. There's a lot of freedom to do that. So different game, I keep saying every game team is different.
Well, every movie's different too. All movies are bad.
We have development managers and development directors that are like basically the producers of each department. It's a well-fueled, well-oiled machine. Art department, design department, web department, audio department. Every department has their own like sort of schedule and project manager that knows when things are due. Here's when this asset's going to be available for you, and here's when it's going to be released in the game. So you have this window. If it's not done, you know, it's not in the game.
Compared to doing like film work, are there any benefits or any disadvantages to the game world sound design, would you say?
I think the main benefit is that it's sort of a living mix. It can happen different ways each time. It's sort of a programmed environment, but that it can always change.
I guess in a way, there's more opportunity in games, I feel like, for players to discover your work. Because like in a movie, if you design a really cool effect in the mix, it gets really dipped out and no one hears it, then no one will ever hear it. You know, in Half-Life, you can go and hit every single object with a crowbar all day, and you'll be able to hear all these things that someone, you know, lost sleep over.
Yeah.
Not Half-Life, though, because they use a lot of stock library effects.